Pixar's 2008 film WALL-E is often read as a politically progressive critique of capitalism and environmental neglect, with its view of a distant future in which the Earth has been destroyed by overconsumption and waste, and in which human beings have been rendered mindless zombies, glued to screens controlled by a mega corporation. But in his essay, Love, Life, and Programming, animation scholar Eric Herhuth shows how one of the film's core themes, the freedom of WALL-E's romantic desire triumphing over his programming, articulates a surprisingly conservative set of cultural values. He also shows how this tension between freedom and programming might reflect Pixar's own anxieties about computer animation, a medium whose reliance on programming conflicts with the aesthetic freedom of hand-drawn cartoons.
So the goal of this recorded lecture is to clarify the argument that Eric Herhuth is making about the film WALL-E and also provide some background knowledge about individual subclaims throughout the paper. And I'm going to break down this lecture into four parts that are basically contexts for the argument that Herhuth is making. So number one, animation as subversion. Herhuth begins his essay by making a rather large observation about arguments about animation in film studies. He'll say, animation's legacy of subversion can be traced back to early trick films, lightning sketches and comics, and the modernist avant-garde, the industrialization of hand-drawn animation, its integration into Hollywood, and its standardization as children's entertainment have in turn diffused much of the medium's association with subversion, disruption, and distortion. Those are two really rich sentences. And I can boil it down very simply by saying film scholars and historians of media and moving images have wanted to attribute a kind of playful subversion that is breaking down strictures or conventions, either social or aesthetic, to the medium of animation. However, there's also this other side of the medium of animation that has become standardized with Hollywood modes of production, often capitalist modes of production that involve the division of labor. It's an industry. So we have this tension between the idea that animation can do anything it wants to, it has utter aesthetic freedom, and on the other side, because it wanted to focus its aesthetic possibilities toward making money, it looked to capitalist modes of production to kind of enhance or harness those possibilities. So you have a tension between subversion and convention. He'll continue. The production processes, creative tools, and aesthetic goals have certainly changed since Eisenstein praised early Disney animation for its protean plasmatic qualities. Nevertheless, its legacy remains active, as the recent work of queer theorist Jack Halberstam and media scholar Scott Buchhoffman attests. Both of their books highlight the tendency for animated media to challenge social order, as well as physical rules. So, challenge social order, as well as physical rules. And often, the latter entails the former in these writings. What does Herhuth mean by subversion? The most famous instance of this is our friend Sergei Eisenstein. We know him as being Mr. Soviet Montage, one of the most cited names in film theory, but he also has some really interesting arguments about animation. He has a book on Disney, kind of unfinished book, in which he says that Disney films are great, which is strange because he's a communist. How does he articulate his interest in Disney film? His interest is purely aesthetic. So he'll say, a being of definite form, he's talking about the cartoons from the 1920s generally, which behaves like the primal protoplasm, not yet possessing a stable form, but capable of assuming any form. A rejection of once and forever allotted form, freedom from ossification, the ability to dynamically assume any form. He'll call this general tendency in animated cartoons the plasmatic. Think of plasma as this free-floating, but also linearly defined thing. Think of it like an amoeba. Right? You think there's something amoeboid about 1920s Disney cartoons. And I'm actually saying there's something similar to this French film that you're looking in the background, the way in which forms are constantly changing, but the lines remain the same. That's the plasmatic. He'll notice it in cartoons like 1920s cartoons, and he'll notice the way in which a desire for the freedom of form, not just lines that move in free ways, but also the idea that you can take an animal and then have it behave in a way so it becomes another animal. He'll say the similar thing about these black and white Disney cartoons from the 1920s, where Mickey and his friends will transform animals into musical instruments. He thinks the idea of transforming is not just aesthetically pleasing. He also thinks it has some kind of political potential, that in a world that is bound by modernity, by rationalization, and by capitalism, we should look to images like this as ways to kind of liberate our minds from social, political, and of course, aesthetic strictures. Now, Eisenstein says this, Scott Buchhotman, the other person that Herhuth mentions this. So the question is, what do we do about Pixar? Pixar is making some of the most profitable animated films today. Are they subversive? Or are they reiterating this idea that the subversion of animation gets suppressed by the capitalist modes of production, like factory labor? So the question he asks is Pixar subversive, both aesthetically and politically? Now, here's the thesis, and I'll read it. The film exemplifies, that is WALL-E, themes of modernization and subversion, and it demonstrates how a playful alienation of naturalized norms can distract from the narrative's perpetuation of specific cultural values and practices. Okay, so he can already tell that he's saying that there is subversion in it, but any subversive quality of the animation, which might be there, ultimately is a smokescreen for conservative tendencies in the narrative. The narrative of WALL-E gives essentialist status to liberal desire and heterosexuality through robot characters presented in juxtaposition to consumerist, infantile human characters. The portrayal of these sociocultural norms within the fictional space of the film is compounded by the playful space of animation itself. So the thing that I want to look at is this idea of liberal desire. Part two, liberal desire. What's liberal about this desire, about the romance in this film? And what does this word liberal mean in this particular context? Let's look at a different definition. He'll say, I argue that computer animation provides a medium for re-examining nature and exploring digital space. Once again, notice that structure of, it does this good thing, but it's also not so good. So once again, animation has a possibility for subversion in the film. However, in a close reading that I will demonstrate, I'll show how the play of alien and naturalized elements can distract from the narrative's perpetuation of specific cultural values and practices, heterosexuality, and liberal desire. So once again, we have the playfulness of animation against the conservatism of heterosexuality and liberal desire. In other words, I just wanted to be clear to everyone that he's making a claim about the film. He's making a political claim, and he's saying that WALL-E is conservative. And this should be interesting because I asked a lot of you to reflect on your experience of watching WALL-E, either back then or now. A lot of you, I think, are quite right to say there's a lot of progressive-seeming politics in the film, especially when it comes to things like the representation of consumerism and capitalism. It does have those things in it. And this is one of the reasons why a claim that WALL-E is conservative is an interesting one. So how can liberal desire be conservative? And I'm saying this by invoking the familiar dichotomy or dualism between these two terms, liberal and conservative. And I think that this popular dichotomy can in fact be distracting or can actually confuse the use of this term liberal and liberal desire. So I think I can clarify by drawing up this one reference to capitalism, which I think is important. WALL-E addresses not only the automaticity of machines and humans working with machines, but also an important ideology or script of governance found in liberal capitalist societies, the individual's right to pursue happiness and enjoy life, which is what both robots and the humans relearn. So Herhuth will actually not reference capitalism a lot in the essay. And I think that's because when he says liberal, he's assuming that his readership are familiar with the idea that liberal means liberal capitalism, as opposed to, say, progressive politics. What do we mean by liberal capitalism? We mean a kind of capitalist society that prefers free markets. And it's like an unregulated economy. And think of this as kind of becoming entrenched in the 1980s with Reagan and Thatcher. And some people call this neoliberal capitalism, or the kind of renaissance of free markets. Capitalist ideology is not just about economics. It's actually something that permeates our worldview. It permeates who we think we are. It permeates our ideas of freedom. And this is from an essay by Eva Illouz, who is a kind of sociologist who thinks about capitalist ideology. So she says, capitalism is characterized by an entire cultural mindset. In that, exchange relationships, that of buying and selling, have permeated most of the society. Right? In capitalism, two parties come together explicitly on the basis of self-interest and mutual economic benefit. Transactions are justified by calculating their effects on the bottom line of a balance sheet. So we can think about these key terms that she's invoking. Exchange relationships, buying and selling, also things like rational self-interest and mutual economic benefit. Now, I want to bring up the relationship between capitalist ideology and romantic love, since that is really important to the film, and it's important to what Herhuth means by desire and liberal desire. It is very strange and interesting that WALL-E seems to be the most romantic Pixar film. So when Pixar has a film in which the primary narrative trajectory is one of romantic love, I think we should pay attention, because romantic love is one of the most entrenched ideologies attached to Hollywood filmmaking. I'm drawing on, once again, this author, Eva Illouz, who writes about not just capitalism and ideology, but she writes about romantic love and how it's tied to the two things. So she starts by saying, here's what capitalist ideology looks like, but our notion of romantic love would seem to be opposed to capitalist ideology. So she'll say, in Western culture, romantic love has been imbued with an aura of transgression. The figures that haunt our romantic imagination affirm the inalienable rights of passion, defy the normal arrangements and divisions of gender, class, or national loyalties. Love triumphs over some kind of social stricture. Romeo and Juliet, right? Capulets and the Montagues can't get together because of a social stricture that arbitrarily says their families are in a feud, but love conquers all. We are invested in the idea that love is this essence, or it's this embodiment of human will and freedom. And that seems to be opposed against a world in which exchange relationships and buying and selling and rational self-interest are guided, right? Love is sometimes we want to say is irrational. That's the beauty of it, right? Now, Illouz will try to say one more thing, to say that while love seems to be opposed to capitalist ideology, it isn't so much. That we can actually look at aspects of romantic love as an ideology that might reinforce capitalist ideology. Individualism, maybe the most important ideological aspect of, or the ideological aspect that ties together romantic love and capitalism. This idea that romantic love has articulated a longing for and a utopian model of the sovereignty of the individual above and often against the claims of the group. Long before the possessive individualism of commercial and industrial capitalism, romantic love celebrated moral individualism, a value of paramount importance to the worldview of industrial capitalism. Individualism is that kind of term that seems innocuous on the face of it, but then when we pose it against other kinds of ideologies, like, say, caring about the group at the expense of one's interests in themselves, then we start to see the way in which it is not a natural thing to privilege individualism as a worldview, but it is, in fact, a culturally constructed thing. So how do we see this in WALL-E? The main thing that I want to point your attention to is the similarity between WALL-E's romantic desire and the desire of consumerism that is apparently dooming the human species, right? Part of Eric Herhuth's overall claim is to say that while the film poses these things as against each other, they are still more or less based on the same idea of privileging liberal desire, because a capitalist economy wants people to consume, and often they consume objects that perpetuate the notion of romantic desire, right? It's kind of one of these like funny things that Hollywood media like to suppress, right? The humans must escape their liberal desire of consumerism to assuage their boredom, while WALL-E's desire is to escape his directive of collecting to fulfill his liberal desire or hedonism, that is being with Eve. And I think there's no better moment to show this parallel than the moment when WALL-E and Eve are dancing in space. They're creating, interestingly, a visual spectacle, right? A visual spectacle not that different from the kinds of spectacle that these people are just gluing their eyes to throughout the day, which is reinforcing their, you know, alleged laziness and lack of inspiring humanity. But they see this good spectacle of romantic love. Therefore, they replace their, say, bad consumption of spectacle with a good consumption of spectacle that gets them to achieve the liberal desire of heterosexual love, right? So the idea is liberal desire of consumerism transformed into liberal desire of heterosexual love, but it's still liberal desire. The film thinks that they transformed, but really it's the same ideology all the way down. It's important also that this is, it's a love script, right? It's a, importantly, a man and a woman who meet. And it seems very conventional, right? And WALL-E is watching Hello, Dolly, a classical Hollywood heterosexual love story, right? A conservative kind of love script. So just remember that this is also tied to Wally's becoming human, right? We only believe that Wally is human once we start to see all the ways in which he has a desire, a liberal desire that seems to trump his directives, right? All his programming. The idea that Wally as a robot, which is programmed by humans, can overcome his programming in order to become more like a human who has free will, right? But that free will is very scripted. It's scripted because it looks a lot like a Hollywood love script. So that's the kind of desire claim that Herhuth is making. Number three, an ontology of computer animation. So what are some of the things that Herhuth wants to claim about the medium of computer animation, right? Because his claims are not just about the narrative. They are also about the fact that this is a computer-generated cartoon. So he wants to start by saying CGI is made with programming, right? If programming through the whole directive thing is one of the major themes of the film, he has to point out the coincidence that Pixar is making animation with computers, right? With programming, with ones and zeros, which would seem to kind of restrict the number of possibilities we might attribute to, say, hand-drawn animation, right? Algorithms, after all, are essential. And what are algorithms other than kinds of directives? He wants to say that Pixar is aware on some level, maybe not literally aware, but it's part of their narrative that their method of animation is in some sense not subversive, that it is programmed, that it is not free, it is not playful. The same thing goes for the aesthetics of CG cartoons. Notice how many times you've seen Pixar films, the aesthetics are hyper-real. They get more and more hyper-real. Yes, our characters have these kind of fleshy bodies that look like cartoons, but every Pixar cartoon has a hyper-realism attached to certain things. And also, when we consider the idea that animation is subversive, this should counteract that claim that animation is subversive, because animation is aesthetically subversive because it isn't restricted to the laws of physics. But notice that how many times Pixar films choose to create images that affix themselves to the laws of physics. So if computer-generated imagery is in some sense not subversive, Herhuth will claim that the narrative will respond to this problem by valuing things from the past, right? And this is an incredibly bright claim that Herhuth says is definitely on display in WALL-E and is also on display in other Pixar films. Think about how much this film is nostalgic for the past. Not only is it nostalgic for 1970s sci-fi films on which the kind of simulated cinematography of the virtual cameras is based, but also think about the idea that WALL-E learns about humanity and his own capacity to love by watching early 1960s musical, Hello Dolly, right? An object from the past. And he's obsessed with these objects that he collects, right? There's so much about a nostalgia that's baked into this. It's always kind of balancing the futurism of the novelty of computer-generated animation with the film's thematic privileging of the past. And he'll say, although science fiction tends to offer audiences the opportunity to contemplate future technologies and the worlds that produce them, WALL-E and Pixar films in general carefully maintain a balance between the old and the new, which is significant considering the association of computer animation with advanced technologies. Let's create a story in which we go back to these familiar notions of the heterosexual family unit, right? Let's like go back to Earth. Let's farm. Let's like make this world look not like a futuristic world, but make it look like the world that we once knew. The image of the future is not flying cars, it's farms. So think about how much Pixar films, according to Herhuth, are really obsessed with this balancing of future orientation and past orientation. And I just wanted to share a little bit from the trailer for Onward. The trailer begins with the voiceover saying these words. In times of old, the world was full of wonder and magic, but times change. And the film's narrative trajectory is really about embracing the past that people have forgotten, right? The magic and wonder is of the past. And finding a way to recapture that in a contemporary techno-modern world is how the narrative progresses. Pixar as a company tries to create narratives that address its own kind of self-hating technophobia. Pixar is afraid that people will be afraid of its technocracy, right? And so it creates stories that privilege an orientation or a romanticization of the past. So just to give you another example, the first film in the franchise of Pixar has a micro narrative, a sub narrative in which you have these two toys, one of which represents the old and one of which represents the new. And the film creates a narrative structure in which the spectators feel a lot of sympathy for the idea of becoming obsolete with respect to technological progress. Buzz and Woody come together, right? Despite the fact that Woody is anxious about being replaced by a hyper technologized toy market. So part four, animation and alienation. And this is very much just a subset of the ontology of computer animation section. So I want to figure out what does Eric Herhuth mean by this alien nature that he brings up in the last part of the paper. So I want to maybe offer some ways to advance the claims he's making. So he'll say by distorting the physical rules of nature, for example, the anthropomorphic mouse and music emanating from inanimate objects, as in Steamboat Willie. So he's talking about 1920s and 1930s cartoons from Disney. Early Disney animation provided a collective dream experience. The audience could laugh together and experience the wonderment of animation in a therapeutic, cathartic mode. He's going back to the first paragraph of his paper, right? Talking about the subversion of animation, right? The otherworldliness of animation. That because the images have unmitigated freedom, they make us think about, say, the laws of physics, that is of nature, of the possibilities of form. He'll say, with its digital composition and presentation of space, computer animation offers an alien nature that differs from the hand-drawn animation of classical Disney. So in some sense, he's acknowledging what a lot of people have said before, that with Pixar, with Disney CG, with computer animation as the dominant mode of animation in contemporary society, we have indeed lost something of the playful forms that we got in 1920s Disney. However, Eric Herhuth will continue. He'll say, but digital animation shares the optical unconscious virtues of rendering the invisible visible. And as Benjamin's comments about Mickey Mouse relate, of challenging hierarchies dependent on presumptions about a stable category of nature. So he'll say that despite not being the same, obviously contemporary CG animation does not look like 1920s Disney, where everyone's limbs are flailing about or where animals are transforming into other things. But there's something about rendering the invisible visible. Now, what could he mean by that? Well, I actually want you to think about this scene that's running in the background. I think it's incredibly important. The moment when Eve takes an ordinary object, a lighter, and contemplates the flame. And it's a moment that happens right before we get this romantic bond between the two. Why would we have a moment in which one of our characters looks at fire with a kind of wonder and awe? And I'm using that word wonder deliberately. Wonder is an aesthetic category. It's a way of relating to the world that inspires an almost kind of scientific sense of, wow, how is that happening? Certain kinds of natural objects tend to inspire wonder. Fire is a great example of them. And you'll notice that there is something special about seeing things like fire and water and smoke and dust and dirt in computer animated films, or like the hare in Brave. That there's certain kinds of natural objects that when they are reproduced in a very convincing way, get us to wonder at how they were produced with such lifelike accuracy, and at the same time, also get us to wonder at the nature of fire and why it is so pleasing to look at, right? Why does it make me challenge the things that I think I understand about the world? And it's crucial that the film has a moment in which the characters are allowed to do this too, right? It's almost like Eve looks at the fire and tells the spectator, look at the fire too. Marvel at Pixar's animators. Our characters, even though they're robots, have a capacity to aesthetically contemplate it. So this reinforces the idea that in this film, there is a distinction or a separation, though maybe a false one, between bad spectacle and good spectacle. Good spectacle is that stuff that happens when, say, our characters look at fire and then fall in love, or when Wally watches Hello Dolly, or when these two people on the ship, heterosexual couple in the making, look at the visual splendor of Eve and Wally doing a love dance in space. Notice that spectacle is also maligned by the film, because it's also the thing that erases the humanity of the people aboard the Axiom. It's that classic dichotomy, is like, how does a film going to critique an overinvestment in media when it itself is a media object that wants to make a lot of money? So it does this very thing, and we can attach this to this idea that CG animation can produce wonder, even though it's not playful like Disney cartoons were, right? So even though CG cartoons are very faithful to the strictures of reality, all the little ways in which they advance the representation of reality through these tiny little naturalistic objects like cloth, feathers, clouds, water and rain, lava and smoke, those are some of the ways we get alien nature, or nature becomes alien to us by being defamiliarized through these processes of recreating their images through algorithms, right? And what is Wally's privileged natural object? Well, we have fire in that one instance, but really dirt. Dirt is a hard thing to render. Why? Because it's complex. It's complex because it's entropic. There's all kinds of details when you make something worn down or dirty or look like it's weathered. That's why, say, the first Pixar film, all of the surfaces were smooth and plastic. So what's brilliant about Wall-E is that it gets us to marvel at dirtiness as a advanced computational or computationally secured aesthetic property. And then it ties that aesthetic property to notions of freedom, right? Because what makes Wally special amongst the robots is that he brings in the dirt from the earth to this very safe and clean and sterile space. And remember, of course, a moment when MO, modus operandi robot, gets off his track by following the dirt path, right? Couldn't be a better symbol than that. This is to say that indeed, Pixar is aware of how it can use animation to capture some of the playful, subversive, nature alienating aspect of 1920s cartoons, in which the forms of animated creatures were free and plasmatic. There's something that it can do by, say, having these moments of looking at the natural world in new ways. And Herhuth will reinforce this. He'll say, in conclusion, the aesthetics of computer animation maintain a kind of alien nature experience that revitalizes the playful quality of animation and cinema. However, and this is him going back to the original claim, this does not prevent the naturalization and perpetuation of cultural practices from occurring within the narrative. So you could summarize this by saying, yes, animation, even CG animation, retains some of its subversive qualities. However, Pixar tries to use that as a smokescreen for disseminating a more or less conservative ideology in the kinds of stories that it tells. And I'll let Herhuth have the final word in summarizing this. In Wall-E, an abstract liberal desire emerges by chance and gains essentialist status, which places the robots in a paradoxical but equal position with the consumerist infantile humans. The idea here is that once the programmatic directives are removed or loosened, right? That's what happens with Wall-E. He is a robot who has a directive, but he has a little inkling, a seedling, you might say, of desire that's against his directive. Once that happens, a genuine nature emerges. And in that instance, unfortunately, heterosexuality develops without its cultural accoutrements. The film is creating a narrative in which you have programming that is then stripped away, but what emerges is in fact more programming, a heterosexual romantic love script that fulfills the kinds of desires that are consistent with liberal capitalist societies. That is the claim that Herhuth is making. It wants us to question the things that we think are natural and are free, as opposed to things that are programmed. Love is programmed if it's depicted in this way. I'll see you next time. Thank you very much.